This is some of the best bang for buck money can buy fun when it comes to buying a car, and we are talking none other than the Mazda MX5. So in today's episode, we are going to be reviewing these mighty Miatas. We picked these up for our Lemon to Lambo flip off challenge between myself and Morgan. So we've got two pretty good examples of NB Miatas. We'll be going through the performance that they've got, or lack thereof, the impressive handling that they have, the styling choices, and reliability of these MX-5. So sit back, relax, as we get on to reviewing the NB Mazda MX-5.
The NB was the second generation of the MX5, and was manufactured between 1998 and 2005. Now, Mazda continued their philosophy with the NB as the original MX5, with it being lightweight, front engine, rear wheel drive, roadster style car, except they brought through a lot more improvements than its predecessor.
So what is powering the mighty MX5? Well, under the hood, you've got an inline four 1.8 litre dual overhead cam engine producing around about 138 to 140 horsepower, depending on which figure you go by. It's rear wheel drive, it's manual. There were turbocharged variants, the SE model giving you a bump of about 30 horsepower or so. They are quite rarer and more sought after, but today we'll be taking you along with us to try and show you what 138/140 horsepower feels like when you're behind the wheel of an NB MX5. So, MX5 performance, probably should keep my hands on the wheel. Before we get into the power, there is nothing like driving a car, having your hair in the wind as you're just going down the street. It's an amazing feeling. If you haven't driven a convertible before, do it. It's a lot of fun. But Mazda MX-5, 140 horsepower. This one probably 120, it's a bit old. First impressions, it is not as slow as everyone tells you MX-5s are slow. Now don't get me wrong, MX-5s, they are slow, okay? There's no beating around the bush. It's an NA 1.8 liter. If you have the earlier model, you've got your NA 1.6. So not a lot of capacity. It's no forced induction. That was a very nice Chevy truck. So that's what you're working with. It was never gonna be power anyway, but that is not what this car is about. It is not about making crazy power figures. It is about smiles, and smiles per hour is the metric that you're going with. So right off the bat, there's two of us in the car. It's comfortably able to pull us along to have a bit of fun. Where you're having the most fun though is when you're in the twisties. So we'll get up to a bit of a straight here so you can kind of get an idea on what a 0 to 100 is like. If you're looking for the statistics and what the actual number is, you can just look that up on the internet. But in terms of what it feels like, that's what we're trying to portray today. And we'll have that for you quite shortly as we come up here onto more of a straight part. Okay, so here we go. We'll just roll into it. 60, 90, 100. So it's not terrible. Like, obviously, yeah, you think 140 horsepower, not a lot, but it's enough for a car that only really weighs about a ton, maybe a smidge under. I can't remember what the exact figure is. So you'll find yourself pleasantly surprised as to the power behind an MX5. And that's not even something that it's trying to be. It's not trying to beat your turbocharged, you know, your Golfs, your turbo Japanese cars. This is your nimble, throw it around a corner and hope you come out the other end. And we'll get to some twisties and we'll show you exactly what that's like, and we'll try and scare Morgan. So we're coming up to some twisty rays now. Now this is an MX5's bread and butter, is throwing it into a corner and smiling on your way out. This is probably one of the biggest wow factors I had when I got the car, was how amazing it is through the corners. And at no point are you scared. It's just happier and happier and happier. And even if the tail starts to step out a little bit, I reckon I could teach a two-year-old how to correct the oversteer. It is so easy. So yep, excuse me, here with some corners, let's have some fun. So, a little bit squirrely, but extremely predictable, extremely easy to handle. Morgan clenched a little bit, but it was so much fun. We'll go around, we'll fang it around a little bit, and have some fun. It's what this car was designed for. All right, so that was a bit of fun. As I was saying to Morgan while I was doing it, I am not an excellent driver. Like, I know my limits. I know that I am not Ken Block. I'm not a good drifter, but even I am able to keep it under control, keep it safe, and it's just a ton of fun all the time, which is exactly what Mazda was going for, is something that you can jump in, you can throw it around a track, you can throw it into corners, and never once are you worried. Now, it does have a limit. If you go into 100 Ks into a hairpin, it's not gonna make it through. But you will definitely be surprised as to how well, especially if you've got some grippy tires, that the MX-5 hooks up and brings you through the corner. So for handling, a massive, massive tick.
So in terms of the reliability of these Mazda MX-5s, now as a whole, they're actually quite good. There's really only a couple things that I've found to be an issue, and that is mainly the soft top. I mean, it's a 20 odd year car. It's the soft top gets old, it gets brittle, it starts leaking in some places. So I mean, to avoid that, you can either get just a new soft top or even go the hard top route. It is on the pricey side, but it's something that obviously is quite important. In terms of other problems, really, you're looking at maybe a coil pack going bad. The other problems are really just typical for a car of this age, a Japanese kind of JDM car of this age. So yeah, in terms of the reliability, it's pretty solid, to be honest. Now for the modding aspect of these, I mean, you don't need me to tell you, everyone knows there's an extensive amount of mods you can do. It, you can pretty much change the car into a whole different car. Like the engine, you can do superchargers, turbochargers, you can do pretty much everything you want. Interior, you can do new seats, steering wheel, head units. It's pretty much as you want. Someone sells it. Now the main part really that you see a lot of people modding on these cars is the suspension, because obviously these can handle like no other. So a lot of people do coilovers, tires, wheels, which these cars do have. So in terms of modding, you know, you're not going to have a problem finding something that you'll want, because yeah, it's just, there's so much parts out there for literally everything you'll ever want. So in terms of the styling of these Mazda MX-5s, now the original MX-5, the one with the pop-up headlights that everyone knows and loves, is obviously Mazda's interpretation of the 50s and 60s kind of roadster style car, you know, convertible, kind of long bonnet. This one has a little nice hump in the middle of the bonnet, which is something that I've never noticed, but it is actually a nice little touch there I do like. In terms of the headlights, I love pop-up headlights. So them going to, you know, a non-pop-up headlight version, I guess the times have started changing. Pop-up headlights had started going out of fashion when these were coming out, so, you know, that's understandable. But going back to the car, there's nothing really that stands out too much. Now, this one here has a side skirt, nice little, I don't know what you call it, nice little aero kind of there. I'm not sure if that's OEM or not, but this one doesn't have that, but that, I do really like that. Now, the wheels as well, being OEM, they're actually quite nice for an OEM wheel. They're quite shiny, nice little, it's almost polished, I'd say. Coming to the back here, the headlights are iconic. You know, I'm pretty sure they're quite similar to the NA version, the one with the pop-up headlights, the one before this one. So I'm glad they kept with these because, you know, they look really nice. Coming around, this one does have a single exit exhaust. The one over there does have a twin. I think I like the twin better, to be honest. Yeah, the exhaust, both of these exhausts aren't the stock ones, but this double exit exhaust does look nice. Now, coming on, if you look into the interior of this one, this is kind of the standard version you would have gotten. Just, you know, regular cloth seats. They all came with Nardi steering wheels. So this one's, I guess, your kind of standard cloth interior. It's nice, all black, looks quite nice. Very kind of standard for this kind of time and era of Japanese cars. Now, if you come over to this other one, this has the leather, I guess you'd call it maroon, red seating and kind of accents around the car. It's also got the Nardi steering wheel, but it has some chrome, leather, red leather accent on that as well. As well as the steering wheel being a nice wooden Nardi, which the other one does not have. So that's also something to point out. That also quite looks, it looks quite nice. Other than that, they're both, you know, soft tops, convertibles. I didn't realize how much I liked convertibles until I started driving one of these. They're awesome fun, just letting the thing down. And you know, convertibles just, they look so, so nice. So other than that, I think that's about it in terms of the styling of it. Honestly, it's quite standard for the time. I guess there's nothing in terms of crazy features and aero or anything like that, but I think it's a nice, solid design that is really, yeah, it's obviously a fan favorite because, you know, a lot of people enjoy these cars.
So the Mazda MX-5, an absolutely legendary car, and it's not that hard to see why. Morgan, your thoughts?
It surprised me almost more than any other car surprised me before, I think. It's just the handling and just how it feels is, it's like nothing I've ever felt before.
It reminds me of like cars, some cars have personalities. Both MX-5s have a personality, and yes, it seems to be the same personality of just that excitable little kid that wants to just have fun all the time. And that is me.
Yeah.
And it brings it out in you because you're like, oh, it could be really cool if I just throw it in this corner too fast. And these both have exhausts. Now, they are different exhausts, so they do sound differently, but each of them, the exhaust gives it that peppy little, like, it wants to go and have fun.
Yeah.
In terms of how it sits with all the other cars, I think,
in terms of if you're watching the reviews for the first time on our channel,
yeah,
we compare it with all the other cars we've owned on our Lemon to Lambo series, so if you haven't checked that out, check that out.
Yeah. I think of all the cars, it's probably my favorite.
Yeah, you know what, I think so too.
It's not the fastest.
No.
By any stretch, it's not the nicest inside, but it is the most fun.
Probably not the best looking. I think it just overall, though.
Yeah.
It's, I don't know. I think we've said it in previous reviews. There's something, like you said before, in a car where it's like, it's got character, and some cars just don't have that.
These, whereas 100%.
They have probably more character, I think, than any other car I've been in.
Yeah, I would 110% recommend an MX-5. Also because of the fact that they're cheap. Pre-COVID, you could pick one of these up for under $5,000. Currently now, you're around about the $10,000 mark or so. But they are coming down. We are seeing prices come down. So it's really cheap, really reliable, handles amazingly. Power for the weight of the vehicle is actually pretty good. It's not gonna blow you away, like we said in the performance, but it's enough. And it's, you can still have plenty of fun with the amount of power that's on hand. And literally anything you'd ever want to modify and do with the car, you can do. There's nothing, someone's most likely done it out there before. There's V8 swaps, SR20 swaps, rotary swaps. I even saw an RX-7 with an MX-5 engine in it. There's all sorts of swaps that people do with Miatas.
So sky's the limit. There's whatever you can think of, someone's already done.
Now there's one blaringly obvious thing though that we haven't covered. It is a two-seater.
That's a, yeah.
If you're after, obviously, you know, you got a family or something like that.
But yeah. See, the car is cheap enough where you could afford another car that has five seats.
Yeah.
So at the end of the day, it's not really as big of a loss as you think it is.
No.
So yeah, I mean, from the outset, you would have probably known that we would enjoy these cars, and these have been done like so many times on YouTube. So it's very easy to see why so many people like it. Having said that though, until I owned them, I just thought, oh yeah, MX5.
Yeah, me too.
And I thought, oh yeah, you know, they're good handling, but you know, so shit. But even like now, having owned one, driven one, I think it's with like a lot of cars, if you own it and drive it, you then can understand where people are coming from.
Yeah.
I'm yet to drive a car that people like, or sorry, I'm yet to own a car and drive it that people like, and I'm like, I don't understand it, it's shit. I would never get involved in it.
Hmm.
And this is by far the biggest surprise factor.
Yeah. For me too, I think. Yeah.
The only probably downside is space inside. That's my big one.
For you, yeah. I think for me, I'm like, I'm perfectly, if I was any taller, I would have been running into the same problems. I think for me, it fits perfectly. Like,
so on the NA MX5s,
yes,
the steering wheel was a teensy bit smaller. So I had, my legs could move. They couldn't touch each other, but they could definitely move around and I could position myself in my seat. This one with the Nardi steering wheel, the wheel is a bit bigger and a bit wider from memory. So my legs are pretty much locked in place by the steering wheel, which is not the best thing, especially when you're trying to turn the steering wheel. So for all you tall boys out there, it is possible. I'm 6'6 and a bit, so you can drive it. Headroom isn't actually the worst thing. No. Like you're brushing your hair, but apart from that, it's actually pretty good. It's just that those legs fitting in once the door shuts, you just get squeezed up against the steering wheel. Easy fix. Aftermarket steering wheel, which there is a lot of options for a Mazda MX5.
Yep.
So literally that one thing would solve the entire problem for me.
Yeah. There's also seat options as well, to put you lower to the ground, further back, all that kind of stuff as well.
So yeah, it's a problem, but it's a very easily fixed problem. If you're 7 foot, maybe not.
Yeah, but I think if you're 7 foot, you probably already guessed that it's not gonna work.
No. So that was our review of the MX5. There's more for your car?
It's a little more.
We've got a couple of things more for Morgan's car that we have to get fixed up. My car is for sale at the moment, so that one hopefully will be sold shortly, and hopefully Morgan can get off his backside, fix it, and sell his car so we can get back to the auctions, because we should have a decent amount of money, and I'm starting to see some more deals flow through the auctions. So, I mean, we have to be careful, obviously, but there's opportunities presenting themselves that we are missing, unfortunately, because we still have these cars. So everyone blast Morgan in the comments and tell him to hurry up. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button. Comment below, what are your thoughts? Have you owned an MX5? Do you hate them? There are people that hate MX5s, which I don't understand. I wonder if they've driven them.
Yeah, they're probably, my guess would be, they're probably one of those
it's big popular V8
Commodore kind of guys being like, you know, only milk comes in 2 liter kind of thing.
So comment below, what are your thoughts on the MX5s? Hit that like button and subscribe, and we'll see you in our next review.